Bom dia a todos. Morning. Um cumprimento às autoridades da Madeira, aqui nas pessoas dos diretores regionais da Juventude e Desporto e da Educação. Um cumprimento especial ao colega e amigo Marcos Onofre. Dear friends from UPA, also welcome. Colegas de Educação Física. Em nome da Sociedade Portuguesa de Educação Física, permitam que agradeça o apoio dado pelas autoridades madeirenses para a organização deste seminário, algo que para a sociedade é muito importante e tentamos sempre fazer em diferentes regiões do nosso país, de maneira a podermos conhecer não só a realidade local, mas também transmitir algumas daquelas que são as nossas opiniões em torno daquilo que é a educação física e o desporto escolar. Um cumprimento muito especial e um abraço fraterno na pessoa do professor, nosso colega André Cunha, que tem tido um trabalho excelente na organização deste seminário. Just to compliment André for his huge job during these days. He was really incredible in everything that he wants to promote to us. I was doubting about what language should I use because English is the official language. But I'm playing at home, and when we play at home, we take the ball or the field. I choose to take the language. So I already ask for excuses for my colleagues, but I will speak in Portuguese. All the slides are in English, so I think they will follow the conversation. If they don't, they could ask in the end. And I think it's better to speak in Portuguese, so it's more easier for we all understand. Mudando então para português, o que nos traz aqui é a conversa sobre o desporto escolar. É falarmos um pouco daquilo que é a visão que, particularmente, a Sociedade Portuguesa de Educação Física tem em torno do desporto escolar, mas, acima de tudo, e já que estamos a partilhar dados de diferentes países, aquilo que vos trago é para também terem esse conhecimento um pouco da realidade do continente e, sempre que possível, pautando com alguns dados da realidade madeirense. Tentarei fazer uma breve introdução sobre a definição de desporto escolar, algo que é sempre importante nestas ocasiões. Depois falar um pouco da relação entre a educação física e o desporto escolar. Vai acontecer aqui um misto, um português-inglês ou um inglês-porto, não português, portanto, peço já desculpa por isso. Um pouco acerca da organização do desporto escolar em Portugal, a relação entre o desporto escolar e o desporto federado e, finalmente, um período de conclusão. Esta definição de desporto escolar é aquela que surge nos normativos legais que sustentam o desporto escolar, o Decreto-Lei de 95/91 de 26 de fevereiro, e que é muito explícita em relação ao âmbito em que se desenvolvem as atividades do desporto escolar. Sublinhei ali aquelas que parecem ser as tónicas essenciais desta definição, ou seja, é um conjunto de atividades que visam a formação desportiva, são atividades que complementam o currículo, são atividades de ocupação do tempo livre que envolvem a participação nos alunos por escolha livre, e devem estar incluídas no plano educativo da escola e coordenadas pelo sistema educativo. Portanto, esta é a base de partida que nós temos que contar quando falamos de desporto escolar. Aquilo que temos na organização educativa e daquilo que sustenta o desporto escolar em Portugal, que está sobre a égide do Ministério da Educação, claramente o desporto escolar complementa aquilo que são as práticas da disciplina de educação física. A educação física é o espaço curricular que permite a todos os alunos, sem exceção, a todos os alunos do nosso país, terem contacto com uma prática de atividade física orientada, formativa, durante 12 anos da sua vivência escolar. E isso é o maior espaço que nós podemos ter para fazer desenvolver tudo aquilo que sejam projetos educacionais, sejam em torno daquilo que é a formação de uma pessoa, seja em torno daquilo que é a formação desportiva de um jovem. É lá, na escola, que todos os jovens têm a possibilidade de contactar com as primeiras ideias relativas àquilo que é o fenómeno cultural que sustenta a nossa atividade como professores de educação física, ou seja, o fenómeno desportivo. O desporto escolar, complementando, é uma possibilidade que é dada aos alunos, dada a todos os alunos, mas que apenas alguns querem, porque é uma opção vocacional. O aluno decide se quer praticar o desporto escolar ou não, e com isso ele vai ter um acrescente daquilo que é a prática já experimentada durante o período de educação física. Uma indicação que tem a ver com o Projeto Nacional do Desporto Escolar, que ele aparece só a partir do 5º ano. Percebi que aqui na região autónoma da Madeira há experiências de desporto escolar a partir do 1º ciclo, embora não, os princípios que estão subjacentes às atividades de desporto escolar são aquelas que estão indicadas nos programas nacionais de educação física para o 1º ciclo, e isso é aquilo que deve ser garantido. Recusamos totalmente qualquer ideia de desportivização das crianças a partir do 1º ciclo, porque sabemos que a especialização precoce não é um elemento que faça com que venhamos a ter mais e melhores atletas desportivos no futuro. Portanto, aquilo que é a nossa insistência de algum tempo a esta parte é na garantia de que todos os alunos, como está garantido pelas leis portuguesas, devem ter uma educação física curricular, tal como a matemática, o português, o estudo do meio, a expressão plástica, a expressão musical e a expressão dramática. A educação, a expressão física ou motora deve fazer, ter a sua posição dentro deste currículo, e é aí que os alunos devem ter o primeiro contacto com aquilo que são as experiências da nossa área. Uma nota só em relação àquilo que é possível em termos de suporte. Como sabemos, os professores de educação física são os responsáveis pela lecionação da disciplina, mas também sabemos que nas atividades de desporto escolar, em função do currículo desportivo de algum professor da escola, isso é obrigatório, poderá esse professor assumir o cargo de professor de coordenador de um grupo equipa. É curioso alguns estudos que nos mostram que sempre que professores de outras disciplinas com uma experiência desportiva elevada pegam num grupo de equipa de desporto escolar, essa situação tem promovido alguns resultados em termos do desporto escolar. E, portanto, é uma situação sempre para nós interessante perceber e todos os contornos em que se envolve. I just put over there in the physical education teachers in the second column some points, because it's possible to have teachers from other disciplines from the school. They have to be from the school that can, if they have a long past with sport, they can organize a club team in school. Um pouco da organização do desporto escolar, um bocadinho, uma referência especial a este primeiro nível de atividades que são patrocinadas pelo desporto escolar, que são atividades que decorrem da prática dos alunos na disciplina de educação física. E esta é uma dimensão muito importante do desporto escolar, nem muitas vezes não levada a cabo em todas as escolas, que é a possibilidade do primeiro contacto que os alunos possam ter com alguma expressão competitiva para além daquilo que fazem dentro das aulas, seja através da organização de torneios, de dias, de atividades que lhes permitam ter uma experiência em algo mais parecido com o desporto. O nível 2 das atividades é claramente o principal nível de expressão do desporto escolar. É aquele que sustenta as equipas dos grupos de equipa e é aquele que mais visibilidade tem quando nós falamos de desporto escolar. Um terceiro nível que aparece aqui, que tem a ver com o mesmo nível de equipas de grupo e equipa, e aparece ligado a uma outra coisa que são os clubes desportivos, aqueles que se organizam a partir do desporto escolar, mas para participação federada. Nós achamos que este aqui tem o ponto onde nós nos vemos centrar neste momento sobre o que é que deve, como deve evoluir o desporto escolar. É claramente aqui que se encontra a discussão. Esta parte está sustentada, esta vive da vitalidade dos grupos disciplinares de educação física e dos projetos de educação física. Esta parte aqui é claramente aquela onde pensamos existe mais espaço para podermos avançar. Dar-vos algumas ideias dos dados a nível nacional, quando digo nacional digo do continente, peço desculpa, estes dados, porque a contabilidade que é feita através do Gabinete Coordenador do Desporto Escolar não tem em conta os dados do Governo Regional da Madeira e dos Açores, embora Isto é o número de grupos e equipas que o ano passado, ou nos três últimos anos, não se percebe bem no gráfico, mas isto é dos três últimos anos, sendo que esta barrinha mais comprida diz respeito ao ano letivo que terminou em 2011 e a mais pequena ao de 2013. E podemos ver que existem cerca de 5.500 grupos, 5.500 grupos e equipa, que é um número relativamente significativo. Informações que recolhi aqui na Madeira, falamos de cerca de 400 grupos de equipa para cerca de 8 mil participantes nas atividades de desporto escolar na Madeira. Um dado também significativo tem a ver com o número de estudantes envolvidos, que estamos a falar de cerca de 180 mil alunos totais, sendo estas as modalidades em que tem uma maior expressão, sendo o futsal à cabeça, depois uma grande predominância das modalidades coletivas, também a sua participação obriga um maior número de alunos a estarem presentes, mas o badminton como uma das modalidades com mais expressão. Estes números, em valor absoluto, podem não dizer muito, mas temos que falar. Nós temos um universo de população estudantil neste momento, com o decréscimo que vemos a assistir, que passámos dos últimos anos de perto de 2 milhões para cerca de 1 milhão e 800 mil, contando todos os alunos em processo educativo, desde o pré-escolar até ao 12º ano. Contando apenas com aqueles que são os alunos a partir do 5º ano de escolaridade, aqueles que estão abrangidos por estes dados e destes números, estamos a falar num universo de 950 mil alunos, aproximadamente, e para os quais consideramos que 180 mil é um número reduzido para aquilo que são as hipóteses de participação dos alunos nas escolas. Achamos que este número pode ser incrementado, que não será difícil que o façamos e que será de todo desejável que o consigamos fazer. A relação das atividades do desporto escolar, que está sobre a égide do Ministério da Educação, com as atividades do desporto federado, é claramente um dos problemas que nós enfrentamos naquilo que é a promoção do desporto entre os nossos jovens. O Ministério da Educação, responsável pelo desporto escolar, tem esta cadeia de organização, que tem uma coordenação nacional e depois uma coordenação regional. O Diretor-Geral de Educação coordena este gabinete, mas não é o mesmo Diretor-Geral que coordena estes gabinetes, e depois tem lá umas curvas que são difíceis de compreender, é o outro Diretor-Geral, e tudo isto cria ali algumas dificuldades de organização, enquanto o desporto está na dependência da Secretaria-Geral de Educação, com um Diretor-Geral dos Desportos, agora que inclui também o Instituto da Juventude, e com as federações desportivas. E sempre que se fala na possibilidade destas duas áreas entrarem em compromissos de organização desportiva, é algo complicado. Devo-vos dizer que um dos problemas que assisto muitas vezes ao que não permite a participação de alunos que fazem a sua prática desportiva ao nível do desporto escolar em atividades federadas tem a ver com o seguro desportivo. Os alunos têm um seguro escolar, têm um seguro desportivo que eles praticam no clube, e esta diferença muitas vezes elimina, são tão, coisas muitas vezes tão pequenas como esta que estou a referir. A região autónoma da Madeira tem aqui uma facilidade, porque o facto da Secretaria Regional ter a seu cargo estas duas dimensões poderá permitir que muitos daqueles que são os empecilhos legais que não fazem com que se possa haver uma maior proximidade entre estes dois sistemas sejam superadas. E por isso creio que aqui na Madeira haverá a hipótese de fazer aquilo que achamos que é o que mais rendimento poderá trazer ao nosso desporto, que é claramente a relação entre o desporto federado, nem que seja através da permeabilidade dos quadros competitivos. Faz todo o sentido que um grupo de equipa do desporto escolar que tenha um determinado nível competitivo possa competir com alunos que estão a competir no desporto federado. Porque o objetivo é sempre o mesmo, que haja mais alunos a praticar desporto, e devendo ser pouco importante se escolhem o clube ou se escolhem a escola para fazer, desde que nesses dois lugares sejam garantidas as condições de qualidade de formação daqueles que orientam a prática formativa dos alunos. Em resumo, dizer que o desporto escolar é claramente uma atividade da escola, é na escola que ele deve existir, é uma atividade que depende do projeto da educação física, e estes projetos curriculares, o projeto de educação física será tão mais forte quanto mais conseguir abarcar a plurianualidade. Portanto, aquilo e cada vez mais tem sido defendido também pelo Gabinete de Desporto Escolar, é que os planos, os projetos de desporto escolar possam ter um caráter plurianual e de preferência de 4 anos. Aconteceu durante muito tempo que uma escola tinha um professor que passava por lá 1 ano, o professor era bom numa atividade, vamos imaginar, de beisebol, abria um núcleo de beisebol, comprava material de beisebol, era colocado noutra escola e o beisebol naquela escola acabava. Portanto, a garantia de projetos plurianuais é a única forma de nós garantirmos alguma continuidade, como nós sabemos, necessária para que qualquer projeto desportivo possa vingar. Uma indicação aqui em relação à complementaridade que o desporto escolar pode fazer da educação física, que é algo que nós que achamos que ainda podemos desenvolver muito, que ela pode ser de reforço. Eu jogo bem handball, quero ir para o clube de desporto escolar de handball porque gosto, mas também pode ser um espaço onde o aluno permita reforçar áreas que tenha mais fracas. Isso acontece em algumas escolas com grande sucesso e com um incremento muito grande do número de alunos nos clubes de desporto escolar. Dar-nos um exemplo de algumas escolas em que muitas vezes o desporto escolar era também um espaço onde os alunos podiam ir, quando nós ainda tínhamos a classificação no ensino secundário, algo que continuamos a lutar para que volte a acontecer como algo essencial para a afirmação da nossa disciplina. Muitos alunos, para melhorarem a sua classificação, procuravam um clube de desporto escolar para poder aí ter um pouco mais de uma matéria que pudesse concretar para o seu currículo. E isso é claramente uma forma de trazer mais alunos também para aquilo que é uma prática de atividade física. Importante também é que as escolas assumam e se responsabilizem pela condução do projeto do desporto escolar. É essencial que as direções e que todos os intervenientes da escola percebam que o desporto escolar é uma parte essencial para que concorre para o projeto da sua escola. E como já disse atrás, a importância de pensarmos em projetos de desenvolvimento desportivo e de afirmar aquilo que são as necessárias relações entre o desporto federado e o desporto escolar. Dear friends, I hope you could understand something about my presentation. I thank you for your attention. Para todos os colegas, um obrigado e um bom resto de dia.
Bom dia. So I will try within the next 10 minutes to give you a short overview on how PE and school sport looks in Germany. And I think it's a wonderful idea to be here on Madeira and that we, on the one hand, learn to know about the Portuguese PE and school sport system. On the other hand, we might give you a little insight how it looks in other European countries. And then maybe in the end we have a holistic picture what PE and school sport can or should be in Europe. Okay, as I'm German, I'm expected to be sharp on time, 10 minutes, and I try to give you the best insight in the German school sport system that I can. So this is what I like to present. I was asked to have a certain kind of structure within my presentation, that it is comparable. And for example, what Nuno just presented before on the Portuguese school sport system, I try to present what is similar or what different in the German system. First of all, the concept of physical education. We had several concepts in the past in Germany, starting in the 70s with an orientation that was close to sport disciplines, but now we have something that is called educating physical education, and it is two directions. On the one hand, it's learning to move. On the other hand, it's learning something by moving. So this is the two parts. And then we have what we call multidisciplinary or multi-perspectivity, means that we have certain perspectives that the children can have to participate in movement activities. I would not even call it sport. I would rather say moving. One, of course, it was the older one, was only performance. And it was more or less a copy of the system that sport was in Germany. But now it is much wider. For example, it can be cooperation. We like, for example, in the morning to run with 2 or 3 friends and talk a little bit. It's not that I can run as fast as possible. It's more we enjoy to be in a team of friends and enjoy moving. It can also be challenging. For example,
my balance here, or the children, can be interesting and challenging, or
if we jump from a 10-meter springboard. Those of us who never did it for the first time, we are quite afraid, and the task itself is quite challenging. So this could be a perspective. Then, of course, it can still be performance, but we should also take into account health. It can be expression, for example, when we're dancing, and it is deep in your culture, I think. It's much more than in the German culture. The Germans cannot dance, but in the Portuguese or in the Latin culture, it's much more that we can express by body movement. But it's also impression, that we make experience with our body, how to move, for example, when we do a forward flip, we feel the rotation, so then it's also impression. But the definition of school sport and physical education in my country is different than it has been presented before. So, for example, in Germany, we understand of school sport, or the translation would be Schulsport, we understand the whole movement activities or sport activities that happen in school or in the school setting. So this is not the complement of physical education, it's a general term. And as you can see here, PE is included in the school sport. So is it, it's a part or just a minor part of school sport. School sport is the whole thing that happens in the school setting. Physical education is that part that is the school subject, or where there's a school curriculum or a curriculum for the special subject in school. And the next level was, I should tell you something about how it, school sport fits into the federal sport, or how the relation between those two things is. Usually school sport is independent, it belongs to the education sector, and it is run by PE teachers in general. It can be also coaches that are responsible for school sport, but not within the school subject. So, and this is how it fits in the federal sport. Usually it does not have a connection, but there are some projects, for example, we call it sport clubs and school, that in the afternoon activities or in the voluntary activities of the schoolers, of the pupils, they can participate in offers that are either run by PE teachers, they can be also run by coaches, but they can be also run by elder pupils. For example, if we have some good athletes in the 12th grade, or in Germany it used to be even 13th grades, then they can also take responsibility, and I think it's a good thing that those who want to take responsibility are allowed to do something and offer or help. First they can assist, for example, a PE teacher, but then if they are advanced enough, then they can take full responsibility to offer sport or movement activities in the school setting. But the head of the school has to allow it. So it's on the school level, and the head of the school decides who's responsible or who is allowed to offer sport or movement activities in the afternoon program. But in PE, only PE teachers are allowed. So then the affiliation of school sport. In which responsibility is school sport? It is in Germany under the Ministry of Education, although it is a little bit difficult in my country, because it is on state level. So you do not have a central curriculum, or you have, do not have central responsibility. We have 16 states, and I can tell you it's quite difficult. So we have, for example, 16 different PE curriculum for the primary school. We have another 16 for the secondary level. And then on the secondary level too, we have another 16 curricula. So they are sometimes a little bit the same, but sometimes also very different. Okay, so let us come to the professional status of the, and human resources of school sport. So when it comes to the subject PE, it is very clear it can only be PE teachers. But in primary school, we have the so-called classroom principle, means that there's one teacher responsible for the class, and usually those are women, so more than 90-95% of the primary school teachers in Germany are women. Sometimes there are only one or two men at a primary school. Often the head of the primary school is a man, but and then there's one or two other men, but the rest, or not the rest, the majority, or the most important part of the primary school, a woman. And 50%, about 50% of the primary school teachers, they are not specially qualified in physical education. They have a general background for teaching, but not special teacher for physical education. This changes in secondary level. There you have specialized teachers, and in Germany, in all 16 states, you need to teach two subjects. So for example, when I was teaching at school, I had to teach mathematics and sport, or PE. So there you have specialized teachers, and the percentage of qualified teachers that have a PE degree is much higher than in primary school. Promoted activities, so what does really happen in the classroom? In most of the curricula in Germany, in the 16 states, now you have so-called theme fields. It's a little bit wider than the sport disciplines. For sport disciplines was, for example, running, sprinting, track and field, swimming, athletics, gymnastics. So now it's a little bit wider. For example, within the field of athletics, you can also do parkour. In swimming, you can also play water polo. So it's a little bit wider. It's not only the Olympic disciplines. So this, I think it makes sense, and the pupils appreciate it. And but still, the extracurricular activities, they are quite close to the sport disciplines, to the classical sport disciplines. Many schools, or most schools, they have one school sport day, they call it. Usually it's just before the summer holidays, when more or less the grades are already done, the conferences have been done, and then in the last week of the school, just before the summer holiday, there's a school sport day. Then you have school competitions. There was one big initiative in Germany, it's called Jugend trainiert für Olympia, Youth Training for Olympia. So that was really a competition on a national level, so they had to qualify within their schools, then they had to do it in the communities, then in the districts, and later on state level, and the finals always were in Berlin, and I always went there when I had the time to watch the finals in Berlin. It was quite interesting seeing the pupils coming from all over Germany for the finals in the school competitions. I forgot sport excursions. Sometimes we have excursions at the school, 1 week, and many schools use it. Some go abroad, for example, when English and French or Spanish is a specialization, they go to, of course, those countries to practice the language. But those who are specialized in sport, they usually prefer to do a sport excursion. Facilities. Usually the facilities are directly on the sport ground, more or less belonging to the school. Sometimes sports halls are shared with clubs, or also outdoor facilities are shared with clubs, so it does make sense. Then the school invests a little bit, the club invests a little bit, and in the end, all groups can use it. But a problem occurs with the swimming facilities. So we have a big problem in Germany with swimming. Many pupils are not able to swim. For Madeira, it would be horrible, such a nice island with a lot of sea and nice beaches. It's deep in your culture probably also to do aquatic sports like sailing. I knew that there was a development from hunting whales now to watching whales, which I think is very good. But imagine those people not being able to swim. What happens if they fall from the boat? They will drown. And in Germany it is the case. Some pupils, they cannot participate in school excursion. When all the classmates go swimming in the lake, then there are two or three children very unhappy because they are not able to swim, and then they are not allowed to participate. So this is really a pity, and one reason for it is that many swimming pools or swimming facilities are closed. They are too expensive. The communities decide it's not possible to go by bus from the school to the swimming facility back to the school. So that's really a problem. Time allocation, usually in the curricula, it meant 3 hours per week, but in fact it is less than 3 hours per week. So there was one big national study telling that about 2 hours per week is average, but not the 3 hours that are really meant in the curriculum. Conclusion. So if you are interested, outside I saw there's a very nice publication from the Portuguese PE Teacher Association. We have something similar. This one here, it's called Sportunterricht, it's the journal of the German PE Teacher Association, so we have 12 issues per year. And it is also possible, for example, once we had a comparison on school sport in Europe. So if there's something interesting from Portugal, I think my German colleagues would be really interested if you hang in one article and explain, for example, how the physical education or school sport is in your country. It's always good to see a little bit other perspectives. Sometimes you learn more when you go abroad and come back of your own country, because you experience different things in abroad. And then we have two international journals. Markus Onofre mentioned it. I help a little bit with those other two journals. One is a review journal, so we are looking what has been published in the last 2 years on certain topics. So it's kind of meta-analysis, and it's a good summary or overview of certain topics. And this one is from a comparative group, and this is also interesting. There we compare studies that have conducted had a focus on different countries or different regions, continents. So, for example, comparing Asia with Europe or Africa with Europe. But it can also be a comparison, for example, between Portugal mainland and Portugal island. That would also be comparing something. Are there differences? Are there similarities? So I would invite you, if you are interested, both journals can also be made available as e-journals. And maybe if you are interested and there's some nice articles in the German PE teachers, and you're much more than welcome to have a look in it. Thank you very much, and muito obrigado.
Good morning again. So I will focus now in my presentation on school sports, because the physical education part in Luxembourg has the same concept than Martin explained for Germany before. So we also have those dual mission, learn to move and learning by moving. And we have also those different perspectives, this concept of multi-perspectives. So I am going to focus on school sports only in Luxembourg. Concerning the concept of school sport, we have two different concepts, one for elementary school and one for secondary school. Elementary school goes until class 6, where the students have the age of 12, and secondary school begins then at class level 7 to class level 12. So school sport is run by two associations, in fact, on national level, and on one side in elementary school this is LASEP. And on the other side, the secondary school, this is called Lazelle. So please have a look at the logos that you see, the little fox for elementary school, and then the other for the secondary school. I will use the logos in my presentation all the time. Then on school level, school sport is organized by school-based associations. They organize the school sport activities then on school level, and those school-based associations are members in the national associations. The relationship between the school sport and the federated sport is that those national associations are members of the National Olympic Committee. So they are considered as in the same way as the sport federation, and they are members in the Comité Olympique du Sport Luxembourgeois, COSL. But in fact, when we have a look on what happens in schools, on school level, then we can see that there is really not much cooperation between those associations, between school sport and the clubs. On secondary level, there is no cooperation at all. On elementary school level, there's a little bit, and I think in the future, in the middle term, there will be more, because our communities, they have in the future to develop a plan between school activities, extra school activities, and activities of the clubs. So they have to develop concepts on community level, and I think it would be good to have cooperation on this level in the future. The relationship between physical education and school sport is, I think, then, when I understand good, similar than it is in Portugal. School sport is a complementary offer and is mandatory, and the offer depends really on the school. Every school has a different offer. And also here, every secondary school has a school sport association and has an offer of school sport activities, but on elementary school level, this is not the case. Only a little bit more than 50% of the schools, of the elementary schools in Luxembourg, have an offer. So you can see that for many, many students and pupils on elementary school level in Luxembourg, there is no offer of school sport activities. So this is, in my opinion, and I think also in your opinion, a bigger problem at the moment. The affiliation of school sport is, yes, not easy to understand, because the official affiliation is that it is affiliated to the sports system by the National Olympic Committee. But the whole system is financed by the educational system. So this is a complex situation. So in fact, everything that is decided depends, of course, then of the educational system, because that is where the finances are. The professional status of the human resources of school sports, it's also a difference between elementary school and secondary school. On elementary school level, it is mostly the elementary school teachers that are in charge of the school sports. And the same as in Germany, we have generalists on elementary school level, teachers that teach different subjects, and they then teach also physical education and also run the school sport activities. But because then those generalist teachers are not always motivated to provide an offer in school sports, there we have also so-called animators on elementary school level. They have maybe some short training in animating physical activities. So the qualification of those animators is not always given. On secondary school level, the system is also then run by the PE teachers. In Luxembourg, on secondary level, we have specialized PE teachers. They only teach physical education. What kind of students are involved? I already mentioned it in the beginning. Elementary school sport is for students from the age of 4 to 12. Elementary school starts at the age of 4 in Luxembourg, and secondary school is 12 to 19, or even more if students have to stay a little bit longer in secondary school. But as I said, the offer is mandatory, and not every school has an offer on elementary school level. What are the promoted activities? On elementary school level, we have a concept what is called multi-sports, which means when you go to a school sport course, there you have different activities. It's not only handball or football or swimming. They change the activities every week or every few weeks. And the activities that are mainly then provided in those multi-sports courses, you can see them here. It's quite traditional sport activities, but there are also organized thematic, let's say, children days, and there are national days, for example, for football, for track and field activities, for table tennis, and so on. Then your school can participate at those children days. You can see here some pictures, not all in the best quality, of those activities that are organized by the School Sport Federation on elementary school level. Okay. In secondary school level, we have a larger offer, a much larger offer. And here we have the different sport disciplines, but also some, let's say, alternative activities or modern activities. For example, we have rugby for both boys and girls. There is an offer of le parcours, martial arts, fencing, mountain biking, climbing, ski, also not in Luxembourg, but in Switzerland, and not every week, only 1 week a year. And we have karate, streetball, dance, futsal, and of course the traditional activities. So what is here? This is the offer of that we have in the program of the LASEL, which is the Association of Secondary School Level. So they organize inter-school competition in those disciplines or activity days in those activities. Sorry. So also here I have some pictures: dancing, climbing, mountain biking, ski. These are all pictures that I have taken from the homepage of this association. You can see it is quite a large offer. This was not the case 10 years ago. 10 years ago, it was only about handball, football, basketball, volleyball, and maybe track and field and swimming. But the last years, the offer has been enlarged a lot. I have many pictures. Okay. Where does it take place? Normally in the sports facilities of the schools, sometimes also in public sport facilities. I have to say that the situation of facilities in Luxembourg is very good. Not for every school, but for most of schools, so we cannot complain about this. Also, compared about the situation in Germany, swimming is not so a problem in Luxembourg. We have a lot of swimming facilities. How long during the week? The offer depends really on the schools. Mostly, the offer takes place in between the morning and the afternoon lessons or after school. But because in secondary schools, there has been a shift in the last years that school starts at 8 and ends at about 2 o'clock, and then students go home, there is no place anymore in between morning and afternoon lessons, in order that the offer has been reduced. Because students go home after school, and only a few stay for sport activities. Before, we had 3 days in a week when we had from 12 to 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we had the possibility to offer sport activities, school sport activities. Students eat something and then they went for some sport activity, but this is no more the case. So this is also one reason because the offer of the different activities is now so large, because this allows to catch more students to stay at school to do those activities. And then Thursday afternoon is reserved for the inter-school competitions, both for elementary school and secondary school. So normally there are no other lessons or courses in the Thursday afternoon, and then those inter-school competitions or activity days can take place. Yeah, so this is the end of my presentation. Now comes the most difficult part. Molti obrigado per la sua attenzione. Not finished. And because, I don't know if you know, in Luxembourg we have a large community, a Portuguese community. We have a lot of immigrants from Portugal. And as our national team is not playing the World Cup, we wish you boa sorte para a Copa do Mundo.
Hello, everybody. I noticed that I have only 1 minute left time. So I could have a very short presentation by saying that we don't have any official sports in schools. So, but maybe even if we are late, I'll tell something about our physical education system in Finland. I have many, many slides, but we are not watching all of them. We are just pointing some important parts of those. But there's something information about Finland. But here is our school system. I could say that our system, it's pretty much the same what Martin and Claude already told you. So we have different... we are in two parts. We have physical education in schools, and then we have sports federations who are taking care of school sports. So we don't have any official school sports. But here you can see our educational system. So we are starting the school quite late. We are starting at the age of 7. The first year from 6 to 7, it's voluntary preschool for everybody who wants to go, and almost 99% go there. After the ninth grade, there comes gymnasium or vocational schooling, and the both of those, they are 3 years, and after that, university and other schools, upper schools. We also have, like in German and also in Luxembourg, we have class teachers from the first to the sixth grade. And also these teachers, they are teaching physical education for the children, so they are not specialized. But after the sixth grade, from 7 to 9, and secondary school, we have physical education teachers. We have very short school days when the children are young. We have only like 3 or 4 lessons per one day. When the children are 7 or 8 years old, they have so-called afternoon activities, but it's voluntary, and the parents, they have to pay for that. But those times, activities, they include quite a lot activity in physical education. In German, they have 16 different curriculums, but in Finland, we have only one. And Minister of Education is guiding our teaching pretty much. Just now, we are having very important times because we are changing our system. 2 years ago, our government decided that we are going to have 2 more PE lessons in elementary schools, what was really great thing. So that's why we are changing our program now. And here you can see that our Minister of Education is guiding the whole system, but then we also have local systems. And at the time, here you can see the timetable, how we are doing. So 2016, we are going to have this new curriculum for our basic schools. At the moment, we are writing all those very important sentences which are guiding physical education teaching in our schools in the whole country. So here you can see that we are going to get 2 more lessons in physical education 2016. And the other lesson, it comes to the grade 5th to 6th, and the other one to the grade 8. Our aims in physical education are, I think, quite popular for you too, because we have this physical, psychological and social aims, which are very important guides for every teachers. And we have this well-being, which is the most important thing in our schools and in our physical education. We want our children to be physically active and healthy lifestyles. Well, this is just a very bad figure. You can see how people in Finland are getting older and older, and young people, we don't have so many anymore. So this is a very big problem in the future. I just go further because time is running, but here you can see that when the children are young, we are having very active children in Finland. But when they get older, the last third one over there is when they are 15 years old, then we are below the middle. So quite many children, that they are stopping activities at the age of 15. Like I told you, mostly the school sports is physical education, but federation, sports federations, they are taking care of sports in schools. We also have one association, it's called School Sports, and it's having competitions for children, but it actually doesn't have anything to school to do with the schools, but it's just having those competitions. But our government has given a lot of money for clubs to have in schools in the afternoons. And this has been a really good thing because most of those clubs, they are physical activities. Like almost 80% of those clubs, they are sports clubs. So this has been a very good thing, and it has been during the years 2008 to 2014. And we also have Finnish Schools on the Move project. It started 4 years ago, and now it's a program. And the aim is to get all the children to move more during the day, during the school day. And Minister of Education and Culture is also in this. And the objectives are to get more active school day well-being pupils. And nowadays we are having quite many schools. We have 500 schools in this, and it is supposed to be growing all the time. And I also want to tell you in the end of this MOVE, we called it MOVE in Finnish, MOVE. We are going to have this kind of follow-up system for functional capacity. Earlier it was so that we didn't know the condition of anyone until they went to the army. In the army they had all kind of condition tests, but before that we didn't have any knowledge about the condition of students. So this is coming also 2016. So they are going to have all kind of measurements when they are in the grade of 5th and in the grade of 8th. And they also will have meetings with the parents so they know what kind of condition their children are. Before this, I want to tell you that we have some local things that we are doing. We have like 10 schools in the whole Finland in the second schooling, so that they are able to do courses during the school days. They have 3 morning sessions for training, and they can get courses for their schoolwork from those sport classes. And different school, they have different sports. Like in my school, we have swimming, football, and ice hockey, and they have 3 times serious training with the coaches in the mornings. And this has been a very good thing, and quite many schools are trying to get this kind of system also now to the secondary schools. But otherwise, we don't have any sports in the schools. Thank you.